Hi there, this is Ranjit from tech2bus.com, and in this video I'm going to explain microprocessors used in our smartphone. Because every couple of days I get into arguments with people when I suggest them a particular model of phone, and they argue that the other X model also has the same, let's say, 1 gigahertz processor, and why not that? It's very difficult to explain in the YouTube comments. The reason is that you have phone A and phone B, and if both of them are even, let's say, 1 gigahertz, and let's say the phone one is running on the ARM Cortex A5 processor and the second one is running on the ARM Cortex A9, definitely the second one will blow away the first one in performance. And to explain you the same, let me talk a little bit about these ARM processors. I'm going to talk specifically about Android phones because most of these phones use this ARM processor. About 95% of the phones use this ARM processor. And ARM is a company which actually is a little bit different from other microprocessors manufacturers like Intel or AMD. They do not actually produce the processors themselves, but they license their technology to other vendors. And the big four vendors that actually produce these chips are, the first one is Nvidia, second one is Qualcomm, they make that Snapdragon processor, third is Samsung, the Exynos processor line, and the last one is Texas Instruments, the TI-OMAP processors that we see. Again, it's not just limited to these four, but these four are the big ones. And before going ahead, let me explain you a little bit about ARM processor. Generally, you'll find ARM processor in mobile phones, tablets, etc. And the thing is that if you noticed a phone, the biggest gripe that we have these days with our smartphones is the battery life. And if you open up a phone, you'll find a huge chunk of the, portion is taken up by the battery. And if you see our modern smartphones, these are actually mini computers because they have a processor, they have a GPU, they have memory, and they have a lot of radios like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, etc. So actually you can say that this is a miniature computer. And if you notice, again, it will be ideal to pack in all these things in a very small space. And again, it should be very power efficient. Otherwise it will drain the battery really fast. And actually in smartphones and tablets, everything is on one chipset, generally known as SoC, called system on chip. So everything, your processor, GPU, memory, and other things will be on that chipset. And as I told you, these four biggies, that's the Nvidia, Qualcomm, Texas Instruments, and Samsung, make these. And ARM does not mandate that it should be like this or whatever. They just license their architecture, and these manufacturers again tweak it according to their liking. But let me get back to this ARM Cortex processor. On the lowest end, you'll find the Cortex A5. And next we have the Cortex A8. Over that we have the Cortex A9. Generally, the smartphones that are manufactured in 2012, the most of the high-end phones are using this Cortex A9 architecture. And as of now, the highest one that is available is Cortex A15. We have just started to see some of the new phones using the Cortex A15. For example, the newly launched Nexus phone by Google, that is Nexus 4. It's based on the Cortex A15 architecture. The chip actually is manufactured by Qualcomm, and it's the S4 Pro. That's a quad core chip. Again, Nexus also launched this new tablet, that is Nexus 10, and that's also based on the Cortex A15, but the chip is manufactured by Samsung. It's the Exynos dual core chip. Again, one more thing that you need to be aware is, and I know this is a little bit confusing, the Samsung Exynos chip that is used in the Nexus 10, though it's just a dual core chip, it beats the quad core chips like this Tegra 3, etc., that are based on the ARM Cortex A9 architecture. So again, that also has to be in the consideration. Again, as you move up the ladder, the efficiency and the power increases. And actually this Cortex A15 architecture can scale up to actually 8 cores if required. I don't know if this manufacturers will produce an 8 core chip, but the architecture can support up to 8 cores if you want. So we might see some manufacturer releasing a super smartphone with 8 cores based on the ARM 15 architecture, ARM, the Cortex A15 architecture in the new future. Also, ARM just released this new architecture called the Cortex A50, and this is the highest end that's available now, but I don't think so we'll find any phones or whatever immediately. By the end of 2013 or something, we might start seeing products with the Cortex A50. And again, it's not just limited to the processor that is used. One more important part is the actual GPU used, and again, that can vary a lot because these manufacturers can use a lot. For example, the ARM actually has a GPU of its own, that's known as the Mali. Generally, we find the Mali GPU in more the Samsung phones. Again, we have a ton of other, for example, like Adreno, PowerVR. So this brings me to the point that when you're buying a smartphone or whatever, just don't blindly go by the gigahertz speed. Look at the architecture used. For example, let's say you're comparing two phones and you are want the best performance or whatever. Look at what is the ARM actually Cortex chip that is used. If one is using the ARM 5 and the other using the ARM 9, I would prefer the ARM 9. Again, it's not as simple as this because one more integral part of this is the GPU used. Again, I won't get into details about that in this video. That's it for now. If you like this video, I'll appreciate if you can click the like button again below, and do let me know in the comment section if you want more of these kinds of videos. That's it for now. This is Ranjit from tech2buzz.com, and I hope to see you in my next video.